Hello. I'd like to welcome everyone tonight. We're going to hear from Pastor John in just a second. Anybody else that wants to come in and have a seat? Glad to see you all here. And we'll get it started.
How's it going? I sent you a contribution. Yes, you made.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So good evening, everyone. We're glad that you're here. I almost said you're worshiping with us. We're glad that you're here tonight. I'm going to do a couple of cheap advertisements first. We've got some of the folks in our young adult program here at church, and they're the ones who are sponsoring this Halloween activity that we have going on tomorrow night here at the church. We have a trunk and treat. I think we have 16 vehicles in the trunk and treat. We have two haunted houses, one that's going to scare the daylights out of you, and then the other one that's going to be real kid-friendly. And then we have craft projects and just a really fun activity plan. So that goes from roughly 6 o'clock till 9 o'clock. So our it's two, three, we call them the 2, 3, 4 group, the 20, 30s, and 40s. But they let me in, and I used to be in the 50s, but I'm not in the 50s anymore. So, but anyhow, that's our 2, 3, 4 group. On the flip side of that, next Saturday, not this Saturday, but a week from this Saturday, we have our fall festival here at the church. Starts at 8 o'clock in the morning, goes till 1 in the afternoon. I think we have 30-plus booths so far, almost all crafters who will be here. We invite you to come and peruse the different craft booths. They'll all be set up in this area here. By the way, do you like the chairs and what we've done with the place? Yeah. We ran into a little resistance getting rid of some of the pews, but that's how it works. But anyhow, they'll all be in here, and then we'll have some food in the other area and stuff like that. So anyhow, that's what those two flyers say. So enough of the cheap announcements. I'm glad to be here tonight. I haven't been here in a while. Part of it is because in August, my wife and I went on vacation down to San Antonio, Texas, and I'm an avid golfer. So on Tuesday, I went out to play the Alamo course down in San Antonio, and it was 102 degrees. And I rubbed two blisters on the toes on my right foot. Now, I've had blisters on there before, but for some reason, they decided that they were not going to be happy with just being blisters. And by Friday, one of my toes was completely infected. And so by the time I got back to St. Louis on that Friday evening, I felt horrible on that weekend. And so on that Monday, I went out to the hospital, and they said, now your podiatrist is going to have to take a look at that. Dr. Lombardo is my podiatrist, if many of you all know Dr. Lombardo. Great, great surgeon. So anyhow, he looked at it and he said, yeah, we got to go in there and cut all this stuff out and everything. So I had the surgery and was home for about 2 weeks. And unfortunately, there was still an abscess area and more stuff went on. And I wound up over at DePaul Hospital, back in the hospital again, facing another surgery. And you know, when you have a medical issue and you think you got it solved, and then it doesn't get solved, you know, you kind of get like frustrated and like, when is this ever going to work? When is this ever going to be done? And I was laying there, and one of the sisters from the hospital came in to visit. And I always love it when either a chaplain or a sister comes in, because I tell them that I'm a minister, and then all of a sudden we talk about theology, and it's great. But anyhow, she talked to me a little bit, and she said, I sense you're kind of down. And I said, yeah, I'm kind of down. And she said, you know, we ordained, or we clergy people, we people that minister to people's needs, we're in the business of fighting the good fight. And we're in the business of finishing the race. And she said, you just got to keep fighting the good fight, no matter how frustrating it becomes, how difficult it becomes. And those were wonderful words to me at that point in time. And whether it's your foot that needs to be healed, or whether it's getting rid of radioactive waste, that's buried underground, you got to keep fighting the good fight, no matter how long it takes. And you know, I know she was quoting from 2 Timothy, where Paul gives advice to this young guy named Timothy who was trying to pastor a church, and the church was giving him all sorts of problems. I'm glad that doesn't happen in today's world. But anyhow, Paul says, "For I am ready, being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near." So Paul knows he sits at the end of his life, but he says these words of encouragement to Timothy: "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all those who have longed for his appearance." So I say to you, keep fighting the good fight. You're going to make a couple steps forward, take one step back. Things are not going to happen the way they're supposed to, but keep fighting the good fight. And sooner or later, there's going to be a crown that's going to be there for you. Not sure what it's going to look like, but there'll be a crown that'll be there for you. So that's my little sermon for tonight. And let me offer up a little welcoming prayer. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for the enthusiasm and the powerfulness of this group, for their determination to fight this cause. It's a good cause. And they're fighting the fight, so see them all the way through. Give them the strength, the energy, the endurance, the sustainability to continue to do what needs to be done so that this thing which is causing pollution and destruction of our very existence in this community can be gotten rid of. Oh God, bless the gathering and the meeting tonight of these folks. Continue to guide and direct us, for we ask all of this in Christ's name. Thank you. All right. Hope I didn't take up too much of your time.
All right. So we just been to church and it feels good. Come on. I don't care whether or not you believe in God or not. Come on. That was awesome. That was. I know you all feel a little better because I know I do. Because I'm going to go into some 1 Thessalonians. Where's Jerry Grammer? Jerry put a great post up on my Facebook this morning. I was pretty discouraged. So after that, I felt good, and I thought, well, I'm going to hunt through my Bible just for a minute, because we are pretty spiritual people. Even if you're not, we pray for you. Prayer feels good, whether or not you want it or not, or believe in it or not. It's still pretty cool when somebody takes that extra moment to think about you. So this verse jumped out at me. Prove all things. Hold fast to that which is good. So we're going to talk about the site, we're going to talk about legislation, and we're going to talk a little bit about politics because we have to. Because like it or not, this isn't just a fight about science, it's a political fight that we're in. And this is the King James Version, there's other versions. The one that I was taught was question everything and hold on to what is good. And that's what we do. If you've been with us for the past 3 years, that's what we do. We look at data, we listen to agencies, we listen to politicians, we listen to people running for office, and we question everything. And what's good we keep, and what's not we discard. And usually by discard, what I mean is we have more questions. And I think the frustrating thing, as Pastor just pointed out, is the fight feels like it continues. And I think the reason is because for every question we ask, when we get an answer, it leads to at least 5 more questions. So then we get 5 more answers back, which then leads to 10 more questions, and so on. So that process can be very exhausting. However, every answer we get to this site, even if we don't like it, and by the way, you all know you're not going to get good news out of this site, right? You're never going to get a report out that says that this is good news, everything's A-okay. No matter the propaganda that's thrown at you from Republic or the people responsible for cleaning it, you're never going to get good news. But all news, good or bad, is a step closer to where we need to be, which is we need to understand. We have to know what's going on at the site before we can figure out how it needs to be treated. And one last quote. I can't believe I'm quoting from eHarmony. I watch this come
commercials and they stick with me. And at least it's not a political thing that stuck with me this time. But at the end of it, the guy, you know, she's going through some cheap meetup with somebody, and he said, "Beth, do you want it fast or do you want it forever?" And I think that that's what we need to ask ourselves with this site for a solution. Do we want a fast solution, or do we want a solution that's good and that's a forever solution? In all seriousness. And the answer is, yeah, we want it done right. We want to figure out what's wrong, and we want it fixed. You know, would I like this to disappear tomorrow? Yeah, so would Karen. We'd like to all get back to our lives, but we're probably not looking at that. We're probably looking at a pretty big fight, and it's going to go on and on and on. So with that, just remember this. This is what we do. Remember this throughout the presentation tonight, because politics is uncomfortable, but we have to talk about it. I'm going to correct Don. It's been 4 years.
Yeah.
Nothing. So I think that's important to point out. So welcome. Do we have a lot of new people? I see some new faces. Raise a hand of first-timers here. Great. Do you all know about Westlake a little bit? Do you know about Coldwater Creek? What's going on in North County? Okay, so Don's going to do a real brief rundown of that in just a few minutes, but I want to go through some stuff here. Here's our agenda. We can go ahead.
Yep.
We have the Westlake Landfill Facebook group. We have about 17,500 members on there, and if you are not a member, you should sign up and become a member to keep up with what's going on in the dialogue about Westlake. We do have yard signs. If anybody wants to volunteer to put a yard sign in their yard, the sign just indicates the next meeting, or we have some Westlake cleanup signs. If anybody wants to volunteer to have a sign, please let me know. This is our Just Moms STL Facebook page. I think we're up to almost 3,500 likes on there.
Almost 36.
Is it? I think this past week we've had about 100 people like our page, so that's great. We want to keep that going. You can go there to get information. You don't get the back and forth dialogue of everybody else. You just pretty much see the updates of the articles that we post on there. We have our website, in case anybody needs to know what that is. It's stlredwastelegacy.com. You can also get to it through justmomsstl.com. We have our Humans of Westlake Landfill, run by Kristen Camuso right here. She just recently had these shirts made up. Are they still for sale, or? We'll have to do another order if anybody is interested in anything like that. Please get with Kristen. Kristen has, she takes all the photographs. I think if you came in, you saw her trifold out there in the front. It tells our story through picture, and it's a very powerful part of this fight. And if anybody out there would like to share their story with Kristen through photographs, she's very easy to work with. Get in touch with her. She's cute. Let her know, and she'll do a wonderful job. These are our goals, and most of you know what they are, but I'm going to go over them because it's important that we keep talking about them over and over. So one, we want immediate relocation assistance for homeowners that want to move and are located within 1 mile of the Westlake Landfill. Fence line paid for by the landfill owner, Republic Services. Two, we want a fair market value assurance for homeowners living within 5 miles of the Westlake Landfill for a minimum of 5 years after fair value assurance is initiated. And three, we want to put the Army Corps of Engineers FUSRAP in charge, because it will remove the significant influence that financially responsible parties currently enjoy while it is an EPA Superfund site. The Army Corps of Engineers is the most qualified government agency to provide a permanent and safe solution for the radioactive waste. How many of you are encountering the smells lately? Still, more often, are you reporting them? Let's make sure that we keep reporting them to DNR. The phone number is up here. It's also on our website. You can find it in multiple places. Just when you encounter the odor, please make sure that you let the Department of Natural Resources know.
there is a new website that is housing all of our documents from Coldwater Creek, Westlake. There was a big FOIA that was released, and you can get to those documents on Environmental Archives. It has a really nice feature where you can put in a keyword and it'll bring up whatever you're looking for. So if you have something in mind that you're searching for or looking for an answer for, you can go to this site and most likely you'll find something out there that will keep you looking for a long time. We have some events coming up. First of all, we all know that pretty soon we're going to do some voting, and so we want to remind everyone to please get out and vote on November 8th. We have the Franciscan Sisters of Mary put on prayer vigil the second and fourth Wednesday of the month at 10 a.m. and it's up at the St. Charles Rock Road, the abandoned Phillips 66 gas station, real close to the landfill. The dates are up there for that. Senator Maria Chappelle Nadal has been hosting her own town hall meetings. Go back.
I forgot to update the slide. It's November 9th and November 30th for the next prayer vigils.
Got that, 9th and 30th. Anyways, Senator Maria Chappelle Nadal is hosting her own town hall meetings to spread the word about the radioactive waste legacy in St. Louis. She is talking about Mallinckrodt, she's talking about Westlake, she's talking about Coldwater Creek, and other areas that she's looking into. So this is also another place you can go if you want to find more information. There's 5 town hall meetings coming up. She's going to have, I think, 21 or something like that, but they're going to be all over, so if you want to attend one of those, for more information, please do.
And also, the senator also gives tours of the Westlake and the contaminated sites. There's over 100 contaminated sites from this rad waste in the St. Louis area, and the senator has been kind enough to give tours to just about every one of these sites in the area, so it can be quite long. They are about 5 hours long. I hate to say it, it's so darn sad, isn't it? You know, that 5-hour tour.
It's a lot of ground to cover.
A lot of sadness.
Yeah, that's for sure. And our next community meeting is now scheduled for November 17th, right here, 6:30. If you're not aware, we've had some major accomplishments. We don't like to call them wins because this situation, I don't think that anybody's a winner. I think everybody in here that has to deal with this issue, you're not going to ever see a win, but you will see a lot of victories and accomplishments, and this is actually probably a very small list now of accomplishments that we have been able to achieve, but if you want to take a look at it, they're on our website, and we're pretty proud of the things that we have been able to accomplish. So now we're going to... Oh, yes. Do we have any elected officials with us tonight that would like to be recognized?
Or representatives
for elected officials?
Hi, my name is Will Sharp. I work with Eric Brighton's campaign for governor. I'm his policy director. I'm happy to speak with you all.
Thank you.
My name is Bill Otto, and I have about 2 months left to be in the state representative for the landfill and for the area you're in right now. So, thank you very much.
I'm Linda Henry, and I'm with St. Louis County Executive Steve Stanger.
Thank you, Linda.
Linda Eaker, Bridgeton City Council.
Thank you, Linda.
Sherry Greenberg, Bridgeton City Council, Ward 2.
Thank you, Linda. Anyone else? Oh, yes. Thank you. I also want to point out that Randy Heim did send us an email. He was going to be here, but he's on vacation. So.
Randy never goes on vacation.
Right. All right, so Dawn's going to talk a little bit, before she gets into the fire, she's going to talk a little bit about some history of Coldwater Creek and the
the waste in St. Louis, just for you that don't know.
Yeah, and I'm going to cliff notes it, and if I'm a little snippy, I'm a little worked up about this situation. So we processed waste for the Manhattan Project in St. Louis. And we didn't just process waste. We started the Manhattan Project right here. We are the first secret city. And if you haven't seen that film, get out and see it. Get out and see and do yourself a favor, the first secret city, because it's the quickest way and the best way I know for you to really grasp. And you'll come to this meeting next time with a really clear, different understanding of what's really going on. But this is a 70-year-old problem. And although we were the first city, we're kind of the forgotten city. There's lots of cities across the United States that played a role in the Manhattan Project. Los Alamos, Rocky Flats, Hanford, some processed, some are locations where the bomb was tested. Either way, all are linked by a radioactive legacy and leftover contamination. And all of those sites are being cleaned up and looked at by the formerly utilized sites remedial action program. We call it FUSRAP. No, that's not saran wrap that you throw over a site. It's actually a program that the federal government invented and came up with because they're the ones that ultimately created this mess. This was theirs. So when I tell you that here at this site, we have radioactive waste that's been sitting there for over 43 years from the Manhattan Project, we have a fire on one side, waste on the other, and they're only separated by about 600 feet, just so you know. When Karen and I started this 4 years ago, we were told that it was 1,200 to 1,300 feet away. Now EPA, after being hounded and pressured by you, this community, and legislators that have ridden them hard, now they've done additional testing and found new and closer areas of radioactive waste that are close. 600 feet is not very far, people. Not very far at all. And some of it's on the surface, some of it's buried intermittently, and really, no, the whole site has never been tested for rad waste, so we really don't know. I would say we know probably less than one third of this site. And really, we need to test every inch of it. And that's one of the things that we're pushing for. Test it. If it's there, deal with it. If it's not, thumbs up for testing and move on. But you're not going to find it if you don't look for it. And by the way, every time they look for it, they find it. That's a fact. There's not a single time where they don't sink a shovel in an area on this site and come back and find it. Which is why I tell you all, we're not going to ever get good news. It's never good news when that comes out. But it's one more step closer to understanding the site, and we need that ultimately. This fire could burn for another decade. And yes, they need to make sure the fire doesn't hit the waste. But there are so many factors about this site. We have a groundwater. This is in the floodplain of the Missouri River. You guys know where the river is, right? It's just right there. You can almost hit it with a stone. We now know that the groundwater is contaminated, and not just with radioactive materials. This was a chemical site. There were lots of chemicals that were dumped, but the groundwater on this site has been compromised now. So the EPA has declared it operable unit 3, which means that it's so contaminated that they're going to have to come up with a decision specifically to address the groundwater, okay? So we have a decision that they need to come up with of what to do with the radioactive waste. But we also have a decision of what to do about the groundwater, because you have to make sure that this doesn't make its way to the river if it hasn't already. We're asking that they test off sites, but for right now, and I need to do that, but for right now, this just came out this past October 14th, groundwater sampling. If you guys have seen the media, the state of Missouri is suing the owners of this site for an underground fire, and part of that lawsuit is that they need to do additional sampling and they're really worried about the groundwater. This came out, review of detection, monitoring, and assessment monitoring reports for Republic Services Bridgeton Landfill. Can you go next, Deb? In conclusion, Republic Services must provide the following. They've determined that yes, the groundwater is very contaminated,
and they're concerned. So as such, within 30 days of receipt, please provide submittal of proposed installation of additional down gradient monitoring wells as part of assessment. They want to determine once and for all what direction the groundwater is flowing. They need to be able to track this contamination or plume. They need to start doing models of it. One of the other big ones, consistent with 10SR, within 30 days of the letter, please provide documentation that affected off-site property owners have been notified. So there's a lot of businesses, a lot of property owners in Earth City that are going to be notified and get a nasty letter. So this is real. If you know anyone that works at these locations, we encourage them to come to these meetings. Our heart goes out to them. This, although this just came out, if you guys have been attending any of the EPA meetings, even as of, what, a year and a half ago, EPA was up basically saying, yeah, the groundwater's done for, guys. It's done. Now we have to figure out what we're going to do with it. So this isn't necessarily new news, but what it is it's a little bit more updated news and from a different agency. So now you have two agencies, a state and federal agency, both saying the same thing, which is the groundwater's in trouble, and yes, it could be off-site in the groundwater, and we have to figure that out. So you can get on our website or on Facebook and look all this up and read it for yourself, but there's a list of things that the state is forcing Republic to do to get more of a better idea of what's going on with the groundwater. Next. EPA has agreed that emission estimates from flaring may be flawed. This is something that they agree across the board. So what's happening is, despite this site, EPA and a lot of gas and oil sites has determined that the formula they use when there's a flare burning off gases and toxins probably hasn't been correct. And they're re-looking and re-evaluating that to determine if there's a better, more accurate formula. So once again, if there is, and they come back and use it at this site, you can expect more not good news. But same time again, we want the truth no matter how hard it is to hear. They have been cited by the state of Missouri for their emissions coming off of the flares. Has anybody seen the site? Have you guys all seen the big tall flares with the blue flame? Has anybody? So the fire is burning chemicals and garbage, and that creates gases and all kinds of dangerous toxins. And that's all being sucked and carried to a flare, and what can be burned is being burned, and what can't is being launched out. And there's a lot of what's coming out of this site that can't be burned. They've also been asked by the state of Missouri to install scrubbers on this site to see if they can get those emissions, specifically the sulfurs, down. Here's the other thing. Here comes the little. They have also, Republic Services has applied for a different permit at this site in regards to what they're allowed to release from the flares. State Representative Otto and Harvey and Donna, everybody's been feeding Attorney General Koster a lot of data concerning the flares and what could be coming out. And so this is a good move by them. But at the same time, we need to see what it is they're measuring that's coming out of this site. And we need to understand scrubbers better. And frankly, we have to ask why they weren't put on 2 years ago. Is this a financial thing? They couldn't get them to agree to pay for it. So there's a lot of stuff. Stay tuned. The next meeting, hopefully, we'll have some more information on it. But this is something that people like Donna have been pushing for a long time. Scrubbers, if they're possible, so we'll see. Helene, did you have?
Yeah, I did. So the radiation sensors, are they impacted by this?
The radiation sensors, are they also inadequate? Are they separate, and do you trust them?
That's two different questions.
Yes.
Are they separate and do we trust them? I go back to 1 Thessalonians. Question everything and hold on to the good. It is very tough to do real-time radiation monitoring. because some of what you're looking for is particles, and that's just hard to test for. You have to grab a sample, you have to go to the lab. You can do gamma, but not all this stuff. Gamma is like x-rays. Alpha and beta, it's like particles that you inhale and that stick in your lungs. Some of the stuff you can't test for immediately, and that's a lot of the stuff that we're worried about at this site. I think that there's also a question of what's happening today versus what happened yesterday versus what happened 20 years ago versus what's going to happen in 10 months. So exposure at this site might not be a constant. Does that make sense? If you had the proper monitors up and you were able to do it and you got 6 months of, oh, hey, everything looks okay, that doesn't mean that it was okay a year ago. So we're always going to have to get used to the fact that there is a level of unknown at this site that will always remain unknown. Now, if there were a large release, a large plume, if they knew it was happening, they may be able to track some of it. The problem is that when you look, can you go back to the fire and the map? When you guys think of the fire hitting the radioactive waste, a lot of people like there's going to be an explosion. No. There's really probably not, unless, you know, a well explodes or something like that, which is possible. Those things can happen. But while you guys can breathe a sigh of relief, that's the worst case scenario is that they collide underground. And I just described to you how they're sucking the gases and emissions out. The worst case scenario is if they collide underground and then that same system sucks all of that and it ends up having radiation in it and launches it out of flare. Because you can't burn and destroy radiation. So, yeah, it's a problem. You don't want these two to meet. And really, besides building a barrier, you need to determine where it all is. Okay.
But are there sensors to pick that up?
I don't think they have those up anymore. I think they took the air sensors down. I know there's area ring monitors and sulfurs, but no, I believe they did a year's worth of particulate tests and didn't show anything above levels of concern. That doesn't mean there was nothing in them. It just means that it's nothing that they're concerned about. And we can get into that at the Q&A because that's an important point. But no, if it were up to me, I think that this site should be surrounded by particulate monitors, kind of like they have a downtown Mallinckrodt, and that there should be alarms on them, and that, yeah, they should watch 24 hours a day for the duration until the radioactive waste is no longer on site. That would be ideal. So, and I don't think it's unreasonable. Next. Oh, well, let's stay here. Was anybody at the candidate forum? Did you guys attend? Okay. Take a deep breath, I'm gonna talk politics. All right. So, we've been very fortunate. We truly, honest to goodness, have bipartisan support. And it was very hard to get. But we have it. And the reason we have it is because we're right. And because the state, it doesn't lie. You can't look at the site, you can't tour the site. Regardless of your personal feelings for a party or for any politician, you have to at least breathe a sigh of relief, going back to Senator Chappelle Nadal, that one is willing to host town hall forums and give tours. You know, we never, if you're a politician in the room, you're never going to get it 100% right when you talk about this site, because it's just too complicated. I can't get it 100% right either. But you can talk about this site and say, we all agree that it's not okay to just leave radioactive waste sitting out for 42 years. You don't just leave it out exposed. You don't, and this is your federal government you're talking about, you don't just let it leak into a creek and not put up signs. You know, there are some basic lines here of decency that have been crossed or forgotten about. And so, regardless of if you talk about an underground fire or you just say, hey, we got left behind by our federal government, you're still talking about the issue, and we applaud anyone that does that.
Well, so, we fought the war together, let's clean it up together.
That's right, we fought the war together, let's clean it up together, absolutely. And this can be cleaned up, and that's the other thing to remember for the politicians in the room, and for those of you who, when we go through this slide, you're looking for maybe a politician that you support that's not on there, this is a fixable problem. There are problems in this world we can all nod and agree on that all the money in the world can't fix. Okay? But then there are problems that can be fixed, but they're expensive. And this is one of them. And I would argue that a problem that can be fixed, but is just expensive, is really not, it's not the mountain that it presents itself to be. Okay, and I say that because we have people in this room that are fighting cancer right now. That is something money can't cure, okay? So this is fixable. It could have been prevented. It still can be fixed. Are we going to be left with some contamination? We might. Maybe it's too late to clean all of it up. But what can be, should be. Okay? So when you're talking to politicians after we go through this slideshow, when you're reaching out to candidates, make sure that they know that. That, yeah, this is going to cost $500 million, but there's three responsible parties, and one of them's your federal government. Okay? That's doable.
And also make sure that they know what our goals are. Let them know what this community wants to see happen.
Right. It's a platform that they need to sign on to and that we're asking everyone to sign on. And it's not unreasonable. We're not walking around and asking them to say, remove this waste now. We want them to advocate for a safe and permanent solution. We want the Army Corps of Engineers to do it. Now let me take that moment and go back. We're fighting many things. When I say this is a political battle, it's political because you have government agencies that are being naughty. And really the only people that can hold them accountable is Congress at this point. And we have to push Congress to hold them accountable. FoosRap doesn't want this site, but guess what? They made this mess tough. And they don't want it because it's expensive. They don't want any sites. They didn't want the airport site that's cleaned up. They didn't want Hanford. They didn't want any of these sites, and they were forced to. There's a landfill up in Massachusetts, back, that's being cleaned up that has rad waste in it, and that Congress had to come in and get the Army Corps and say, get in here and help this. Get in here and get this. So this has been done before. They have a history of not wanting to clean up what's theirs and having to be made to do it. And as far as programs needing appropriation and more money, they're spending $1 trillion on nuclear weapons. Now, I don't care if you're for or against nuclear, that's not the issue. The issue is this. They have to clean up after the first nuclear weapons ever made. They have a responsibility and they need to be made to do it. They can take some of that money to come back and do this right. When you have an agency that says, well, we don't have the proper funding, so we can't take the site, you'd think that would be a good excuse for them to go and seek more money. How do you, as an agency, ask for more money when you're not taking new sites and you're not saying, hey guys, look at all these sites we're taking. This is why we have to have these funds. Let's also be careful of one other thing. St. Louis, this entire area, if you go on Senator Maria's tour, has been exposed to radioactive waste. There are over 100 sites, as Robin said, and there were exposures at those sites. There are programs out there like the Downwinders program that, where the federal government comes in and acknowledges exposure and sets programs and health monitoring up. They do this in other communities. They're gonna say they don't have the money for that either. So we have to be real careful using that excuse, saying, well, they don't have enough money. You know, there's ways of getting that money. And if we have to come together and go to Congress and say you need to give them more funds, we can do that too. So I don't say that to discourage you, but I've had a lot of messages this week. Well, the Army Corps, they says they don't want it. Yeah, that's what they said at the airport. And by the way, they wanted to put more waste at the airport. Okay, they don't want any of these sites. That doesn't mean, it doesn't matter. It belongs to them and there are ways of making them take it and helping them to pay for it. So moving on with the candidate forum, here's a really great picture at the top. You can go to the next one. If you don't see the candidate up here running against him, we offered everybody and some declined It doesn't mean that they don't support the platform, it just means they declined and we don't know. So please feel free to reach out and have them sign on to our platform, okay? We have a few weeks left before election. It would be great to get these people to publicly support this. Senator Jill Shute was here in proxy for candidate for Governor Chris Koster, supports the entire platform, from buyout to FUS wrap to removal, all of it. Candidate Russ Carnahan, Lieutenant Governor, again, all these people have signed onto the platform. Teresa Hensley was not able to make it, but she sent one of the attorneys, Monica Penrose, and she supports it. Next. You get it? Candidate Jason Kander, running for U.S. Senate against Senator Roy Blunt, supports it. Stephen Bailey, running for U.S. Representative District 1 against Lacey Clay, supports it. Representative Bill Addo, right here up in this area, also running for Congress against Dan Wagner. Of course he supports it. He's been here since the beginning. Candidate Mark Matteson, who is right there, can you wave? Supports it, running in the 70th as Republican. And then there's two candidates here running against each other. Byron DeLeer, running in the same as a Democrat, supports the platform. Richard Orr, State Senator District 23, that's St. Charles, right? Or is that O'Fallon? St. Charles, okay, sorry. Which is right across the river, which is great. We've got everyone around supporting it. Next, Kenny Bierman, Democrat running for State Rep 65. Where's that? That's O'Fallon, right? Is that St. Charles too? Okay, well, supports it. Huh? Orchard Farm, okay. Keith English, who was a Democrat in the 68th and is now running as an independent, supports it and has introduced legislation in the House, along with Senator Chappelle Maddow. Candidate Mary Nichols, Democrat, 72, supports. So does Dan Hyatt. Those two are running against each other, Democrat, Republican. Again, bipartisan support. This is great. Vicki England, running. Afton, South County?
Melville.
Got my down south mixed up a little bit. Supports it. Amy Pelker, Republican, running for St. Louis County Council, District 2. This is District 2 right here, County Council. Supports it. Sam Page supports it. Those two are running against each other. Curtis Faulkner, Republican, District 4. Now that's Florissant, right? Jennings? Yeah. Come on. Okay. Just ask Karen if you want to see the map. There were two videos. So Senator Roy Blunt wasn't here in person. He had a fundraiser that night. So he sent in a video pledging his support, as did Congresswoman Ann Wagner, and I don't even really know. I think she was candidating for somebody out in Arkansas. I'm not really sure. But she also sent a video supporting it. We did give them the option of videos, which I know some people weren't happy with, but honestly, and I'm not here, I wish they'd come out in person, but we wanted this to be for you guys, so you guys could see, and if you're not happy that they're on video, then that's up to you guys to call them and say, hey, I really wish you were here in person. So again, if you don't see the candidate up here that you're interested in for other issues or whatnot, please feel free to reach out to them. We can help with that. We've got materials, handouts. A lot of them we have campaign numbers for. We know their campaign folks. We can just give them to you and have you call. And it would be great to get everyone on the platform, regardless of who wins, because we want to make sure that we get them before the election. But we also want to make sure we get them after. One of the things that we asked them, we asked a lot of questions up there, but we asked them once they win, and they all agreed, to designate one staff person to be here for these meetings, to be here for EPA meetings, and to be able to work with us, our go-to person, and really for you guys too, that we could say, hey, here is one person from this person's office, they report directly to your congressman, your senator, or who, your representative, and they've got their arms around this issue, because it is really complicated and it changes. And if you have a bunch of people, it's hard to keep everyone up. So That's where we are, candidate-wise. That wasn't too tough, was it, politically?
I know.
I am okay. I was more worried that you guys would, because we walk a very fine line. We have to. I will say this, as of our Facebook page, we have made a rule that we've always kept politics off the page. We really have. But it and flyers and such, if you do an ad, or if a politician does an ad and they mention Westlake in it, then it can be posted on the page. That's the rule. And I know that's tough because a lot of these people pledge that they do, but they don't, you know, there's limited funds. I get that. They have to be careful what they put on flyers. But still, we can only put stuff like that up if the person, if Westlake is mentioned somewhere in it. Okay, and even that's kind of a gray area for us. But again, we've had so many people say we want to be able to see who supports this issue and that they want it on Facebook. Obviously, if it's misused or it gets crazy,
disrespectful or anything like that,
right,
it'll be taken down and the whole entire post will go away.
Yeah, so don't. Hopefully nobody ruins it for everyone else.
It's been a tough campaign all across the board, and I know everybody is probably going to be really happy when this next 2 weeks is over, but it's really tough on Dawn and I to have to monitor everybody's opinion that's on the Facebook page. We don't want to kick anybody off. We respect everyone's opinion, but your opinion has to be respectful to other people, and you know, we don't want to go back and forth and air dirty laundry and all that stuff. We want to keep this about the issue. And if, like Dawn said, if there's a flyer or an announcement of some sort that has Westlake information in it, then we will allow it.
Right, until somebody ruins it for everyone. Last but not least, we want to make sure, if you're running for office or you already hold office, we want to make sure that we're available for you, or that we put you in contact with people who can help you. We have the Franciscan Sisters of Mary. We have Missouri Coalition for the Environment. There's a large group of people. We've got the Washington University students here. Can you guys raise your hands? Because we're so excited to have you here. Who, by the way, they're going to the Joe Biden event tomorrow.
Oh,
cool. Yeah. No signs. They don't have t-shirts, so it's doubtful they'll be able to get this to them. And we have reached out to Mr. Kander's campaign to see if maybe he would introduce. I don't know. Don't hold your breath. Mr. Biden's got to be lots of places tomorrow besides St. Louis. But we want to make ourselves available to you if you have a campaign so that you get what you need from us to best understand the issue. So we're trying to be respectful of you. And the last thing that I will say, I'll repeat what I said earlier. If you're talking about this issue, even if you're a person or you're running for office, please don't be afraid to talk about this issue. You're going to make mistakes. We get that, and we're not going to hold you accountable. Nobody here can talk about it and get everything right, you know, but please at least try. Please at least try to mention it in a flyer or ad. Please at least mention that it's an important issue, because you'd be surprised at how powerful that can be and how helpful that can be to this cause. People feel very isolated when they live next to a site like this, and even just you mentioning it means that they're not forgotten. Feel like there's that level of protection, somebody's looking out for them, and it means a lot. So you know, if you want to mention it and you don't know what to say, please come see us. We've got handouts, we can send you places. CD, can I call you out? Can you raise your hand? CD's back there if you're interested in seeing the first secret city. He did a great job. He worked his bottom off, and he's kind of the go-to person if you want to know about the deep history and what all has happened at all of the sites, so you can kind of wrap your head around that. But he's the one who produced the first secret city. So if you have any questions, you can always talk to him about it too. Okay? Neil, can you raise your hand? Neil Burnbaum is here. We stay away from lawyers, but Neil is here to help for anybody that took any settlement recently. If you have any questions on what to do with your tax forms, please go back and see Neil. He has some clients in Spanish Village. He's dealing with the settlement issue. He'll be more than happy to talk to you about it. Raise your hand again so everybody can see you.
Don, can I just say one thing?
One.
Just one thing. Is it the important thing? Is that the IRS is saying that it's...
She's going to get you a microphone real quick.
I'm going to hold the microphone.
Okay, the only thing I want to say is we got a call from a Bridgeton resident. We took a settlement, and now the IRS is saying that those settlements are taxable. And I just want you to know we're winning cases. We won our 10th case, and they're not taxable. So anybody that paid taxes on that, and I'm not trying to act like I'm, you know, I feel for you guys. I'm humbled, really, after coming here, because we're charging 10% of the money that you get back, and nothing if you don't get anything back, but we haven't lost any cases yet. So I'm just saying, anybody that just took that 1099 miscellaneous after paying a 25 or 30 or 40% lawyer fee, I was motivated because I just thought it was a big ripoff, and anybody that wants to talk to me, I've just left some flyers here. I'll leave them back here, and if you guys have any questions, thank you.
Thank you, Neil.
Thank you.
Thank you a lot.
We're going to open the floor for questions, answers, and comments.
Oh, we're also passing our donation basket around. If you would like to donate to help this cause and help out with advertising and materials and babysitting and everything that we do. And we're always looking for volunteers. So if you have something that you can do and you do it well and you want to volunteer, that would be great. So, question.
Or comment.
I apologize. I was not at the candidate forum. So are you saying that every person who is represented there fully supports the platform? That's fantastic. I only heard it for the first couple, so I just want to make sure it was all. Thank you.
That is fantastic, and it was a lot of work, and it's a lot of the people in this room that reached out to them and educated them, and we were really blown away. We were blown away by that, and so when I say there's bipartisan support, you can see it. There's truly bipartisan support.
Anyone else?
Are Blunt and, who are now the elected officials that you want people to be calling?
We're
going to
get political. Guys can handle it. It's so close to the election. Congress is not in session, and so it's not going to do any good to call them, unfortunately, because they can't get anything passed now anyway. The time is up for that, at least for this election, and that's a big bummer. That's a bummer.
Because I've been calling Blunt and Wagner.
I'm curious to hear what they're saying. Are they telling you guys anything? Because, again, guys, this isn't a hard lift. This is the bill. There is a bill in Congress right now. It did pass the Senate unanimously, but it's in Congress to transfer authority of this site to the Corps of Engineers. And no, it's not a heavy lift, and it has been done before. Yeah, the Army Corps is saying we don't want it, and EPA's lobbying, which is illegal behind the scenes, saying, don't take this site from us. Don't take it. We got it. We promise. We'll fix it. We promise. A little too late for that, but... Which really stinks that we have our federal, you know, you have Republican other the people that want, have to pay for it that don't want it transferred, but to really think that your federal government's pushing against you is hard. But the fact of the matter is you've got people like Senator Blunt that sit on these committees, and frankly, he's in the majority, so is Ann Wagner. You guys do know, right, that bad bills get passed all the time, right? And that it's a matter of horse trading. I mean, this is how it works, and it's disgusting. You pass my bill, and I'll give you this. That's what's done. To my knowledge, there hasn't been any of that on this. It doesn't really feel like there's a very strong push to get some of the people out of the way. That's what it feels like.
They're not. I asked them to confront the people that oppose this bill in the media.
What'd they say? That's great, right there.
I don't get an answer.
Well, they won't, because a lot of them are from their same party. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to call it the party because it's election time, and they don't want that. But at the same time, they owe it to these people to call out people that are misbehaving and at least give us the opportunity to call them up, because we're good at that.
Right.
And we're not even getting that opportunity.
And I also asked Blunt for $500 billion to go to food wrap.
But he would be the one to appropriate. He's on the right committee for
right.
that, and he has
right.
the right connections. And the truth of the matter is, he should have done that anyway, because
right.
we have other sites in St. Louis that need that money from FUS RAP too, not just Westlake. So,
and this is the basis of the resistance is coming from FUS RAP jealousy.
Well, it's the federal government.
Because Pallone wants it for his state, is that right? Or
yeah,
you don't even know.
That's fed by the Army Corps of Engineers. They play that game with elected officials, and they play it with people too. And they say, hey, if Westlake gets sent over to us, we may not be able to pay enough attention to your site. And those people that know us know that if that were the case and that were presented, I think you know what we tell them to do. To where to go. You're like, no, you're not gonna hurt them to help us. You're gonna help all of us. And oh, by the way, we're coming with tents. We're coming with tents and to camp out on your front line. That's what we would be telling them. So that was made abundantly clear, just so you all know. When we went to these congressional officials to write this legislation, we made that clear, because we understand that there are other sites in St. Louis, and we said we will not sacrifice one site for another. So we were promised that the appropriate appropriations would be given, and that was made to understand, just so you know.
This isn't a question, but I was wondering whether, just for the new people in the room, you could explain what some of the health effects are for the nuclear waste legacy in St. Louis.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I think we need to bring it back down to what this is really about. And it's about the people in St. Louis, North County, and around Westlake Landfill that are sick and dying. It's about our kids that have bloody noses, asthma, can't breathe, fatigue, nauseated, memory loss. It's about autoimmune diseases, lupus and rheumatoid arthritis, and people that can hardly get out of bed sometimes, like myself. I grew up near Coldwater Creek and was exposed to Coldwater Creek all my childhood. And now I am sick and have health issues. And so we have these kids that live in Spanish Village that are breathing this air coming out of the landfill. Even if it's not radioactive waste, it's still toxins and chemicals combined, and no one knows what the effects are when you mix all of those chemicals and you breathe them for 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, now going on for 6 years, anticipated to go on for another 10 years. This isn't the first landfill fire that Republic Services has. They have one in countywide Ohio that's been burning now for 10 years, and they have illnesses around their landfill. They're not new to this. This is
our third fire here.
And this is our third fire that has happened in the landfill. Two of them were in the 90s, and close to radioactive waste. And going back to the Coldwater Creek, we know what it looks like to live and be exposed year after year to radioactive waste that's left over from the atomic bomb. We see it in North County. We have cancer clusters. We have other illnesses outside of cancer, chronic illnesses. They're cleaning it up. They wouldn't clean it up if it wasn't really hurting someone. And we have to continue to make sure that they clean it up. All over North County. It's in parks now. It's in people's backyards. Those people, to me, live like prisoners in their own homes. Because do you want to go out in your backyard or send your kids out in their backyards and know that there's radioactive waste from the Manhattan Project laying out there? Don't garden. Don't till anything up. You know, the people that live in Spanish Village are prisoners in their homes because you can't go outside sometimes You can't open your windows. I haven't opened my windows probably in 3 years when it's a spring day or a fall day. My air conditioner is on now and it'll go straight to heat when it need be, because we don't know when we're gonna get hit with the odor. You know, trips to the park with our kids looks like a whole bag full of masks and inhalers and nose spray and eye drops and whatever else they need, because you never know when that smell is gonna come upon you. Go shopping, come out, you're hit with the smell. Every aspect of these people's lives that live around this landfill has been affected in some way or form. And unfortunately, when we talk about there will never be a win, we may be looking at people 10 years from now sitting in this room that have been fighting this fight that are dying of cancer. We do it. Dawn and I do it every day. Every day someone messages us and says they're sick. They're going to the doctor. They're scared. They go to the doctor. They find out they have cancer. They come back. They tell us. And 6 months later, their daughter or their son or their grandchild is messaging us saying that they've passed. These cancers are rare and they're aggressive. And they're taking the lives of St. Louis residents. And the only way that we can stop this is so that we all come together and we all stand up and we all push in the same direction and we protect our kids. I don't want to be here 5 years from now. I don't want my kids to be here, standing up here, going to elected officials' offices. It is so stressful for me and Dawn to go to Washington and leave our kids, leave our family, and go there and fight this fight. And we do it because we have to. If we don't, then we're part of the problem. If you don't become part of the solution, you're part of the problem. And we're going to get some elected officials in there that are going to be part of this solution. We have some strong people in our corner, and we have to continue to push them. I don't think anyone in this room wants their child, their mom, their dad, exposed to this stuff any longer. So whatever you can do. I notice there's a lady back here in the back. And if you need to, I haven't read any of it, but I can see pictures and I can tell what it is. If you need to know something, I think she's a walking billboard. And I think if you wanted to look at what she has back there, you'd probably get the story pretty quick. So,
thank you for coming, by the way. That's awesome.
Yeah.
It really is. Thank you. I'll just say one thing. It's not like catching the flu, guys. You can't become unexposed. That's just not how it works. You know, and you don't get sick right away with this stuff. That's not how it works. And there really isn't much in the way of testing to say, oh, I have or have not been exposed. And so that is why this problem, I think, in my opinion, has continued in St. Louis. Because you have a period of time where it takes these symptoms and these illnesses so long to come up that you're not, if it were sudden and that you were to see bodies in the street or in the yard or sudden a blood test, like in Flint, a lead blood test, then it would be different. Because then you could say for certain, oh my gosh, look what happened, this person was exposed, here we go. But just like Flint, that problem's still ongoing. Nothing gets solved unless you push for it. It doesn't get solved because the problem is well defined. It gets solved because you push. And that's where we are right now. If you talk to CD in the back of the room, he used to work for the Riverfront Times, did I get that right? He will tell you, how long have you been reporting on this? 1991. A lot of this information we're telling you now was known then, and he reported it. He can show you all his articles. Why St. Louis hasn't come together and fixed it, I don't know. But you know, it needs to happen. Regardless if you're Coldwater Creek, which by the way, if you want to know more about that, Coldwater Creek, Just the Facts Please, has a Facebook page and a website, and you can go to our website and we have a link for it to see some of these illnesses. But it's all the same waste, you guys. And
not to blow your mind, but if you want to talk to CD, it's over in Illinois too, Venice, Illinois. It didn't just stop at the Mississippi. This issue's huge, and those people are sick too, just like we are. So we know, if you want to go to Hanford, you can see the illnesses around Hanford. Every time somebody is exposed to this same waste, people get sick.
And believe it or not, there's still a lot of people out there in St. Louis that don't even know this is happening. They don't know about West Lake Landfill. They don't know about the Bridgeton fire. And they don't know about Coldwater Creek and the exposures all over North County. They don't know the role that St. Louis played in the making of the bomb. And
they don't know about Weldon Springs.
They don't know about Weldon Springs. And when Dawn and I started this, you know, we were two crazy women talking about something crazy. And it's taken us a long time to build up, to educate elected officials and our community. And whatever you can do, tell your friends, tell your family, tell friends and family out of town. Tell everyone what is happening to us here in St. Louis.
Could you touch on, aside from the physical effects, some of the psychological effects for the community?
Yeah, and there's a, do we have that picture? Do you have the ability to log on to Humans of Westlake?
Yeah.
And can you pull the picture up that Kristen Camuso took when you just flipped it over your head? Remember that picture? And Kristen, who's Kristen up here? I think I can talk about it, but I want you to see a picture if she can get it up. It's really powerful. So we were at a meeting up in North County with Foos Rep, talking about what they were finding in the creek in people's backyards. A lovely lady got up who lives next to a park that's contaminated. She's dying of lung cancer. Never got to be a nurse, but I never smoked. Walked the park every night to try and stay healthy. Anyway, Kristen raised a camera up over her head, kind of like you would if you were to take a selfie, but just to get behind, to get everyone's face. And I think you'll see it on, because a picture's worth a thousand words. But yeah, psychologically, there's two parts to it. I know Donna's been doing a lot of, Robin's been doing a lot of educating. And even tonight, I can pick people out in the crowd. Neil, if I wouldn't have known you, you were changing colors when we were talking. I can pick people out in the crowd now. We've gotten to the point that don't know a lot about it, but know a little bit. And you can tell when you struck a nerve or you've hit them because they just get that look on their face. And as much as you think that would make us relieved because we're like one more person gets it, it's the opposite for us because there is a part of us that wishes we could go back 4 years and not know this. You can't unlearn this because it really does stick with you. And there are times when there are people that we know of that are hurting, that have sick relatives. I won't mention them by name, but I remember when Karen started the page, we would converse. We would say, because people kept joining the page, and we knew this family had been through so much heartache, and we thought, well, there's going to come a day when they ask to join this page. When they do, they're going to get on, and they're going to learn about all this, and it's just going to break their heart. They've lost so many loved ones, and they're still hurting from it. And I remember when that day happened, and that one person asked to join, and Karen and I talked about it, and I thought, that poor woman's life will never be the same. The moment we click and accept and put her on this page, that's it. That's it. And she reads about this. She can't unlearn it, and it's gonna hurt.
It answers questions, it opens up awful wounds, and for those that have buried their loved ones and thought that accepted the cancer or the illness or whatever it may be, accepted their death and started their grieving process and moving on with their life, get slapped in the face with what they were exposed to and what they could have died from. And that's not good news to tell anyone, and it's really a tough thing to do, to watch someone psychologically watch someone that you tell about this issue and things start clicking in their mind and you know where it's going.
The other thing, we call this a living hell. You know, when, for those of you that know mythology, the gates of hell have a saying over them, abandon all hope, ye who enter. This will suck the hope right out of you because your federal government's involved and they're at fault and you're fighting them. And that in itself is a psychological twist. It really shakes your faith in government, but it makes the situation seem hopeless. And when that happens, it's hard to get people to want to fight and to re-energize. So from a psychological standpoint, this really does create a living hell for people.
Hi, I'm Byron DeLeer, and I'm a candidate running for state representative here for the District 70, which is Bill Otto's open seat. And I know that this situation can seem very hopeless. I've spent hundreds of hours studying the history and the primary source records associated with this site. And but I do want to share with the group a little bit of hope, because I was out knocking doors, as we candidates have to do when we're running for office, and I was approached by a gentleman and his young boy. They were actually waiting while I was talking to a neighbor in Maryland Heights, and as soon as I got done with that door, they came up to me and they said, are you Byron DeLeer? And I said, yes, I'm Byron DeLeer. I said, well, my son here is interested in doing a research paper on the West Lake Landfill. And he goes to Pattonville High School. And his name was Jared McCormick. And so I met with Jared a few days later and shared with him a lot of the information about the landfill. And the reason why this offers a little bit of hope is because if we can impart to our younger generations all the information and knowledge that we have accumulated as a community, as an activist community, to get action on this issue, we will be able to carry forward a broadening spectrum of opinion that will eventually get resolved. And like John mentioned in his opening remarks, this is a righteous cause. Because we are right. This site needs to be cleaned up. And to give you a perspective on the maybe 50,000 foot view of the history of the contamination of the region, out of the five huge caches of nuclear waste in the region, those sites being downtown Mallinckrodt, the airport site, Laddie Avenue, and Weldon Spring, Westlake is the only remaining huge cache of nuclear weapons-related byproduct material that has not been dealt with. And there are two other characteristics about Westlake that are outliers. And I know that this has been shared a lot, but it's important to repeat some of these points. One is that all those other sites, those 100 other contaminated sites, have been under the jurisdiction of the Army Corps of Engineers Federal Cleanup Program, whereas Westlake has been excluded. And then of course the other outlier concerning Westlake is the fact that there's an underground fire that's threatening to incinerate the waste. So we have such unusual circumstances here that need to be addressed immediately. I believe that the EPA has been doing a great disservice to this community by concealing evidence, by concealing criticism of the record of decision that came out in 2008. In fact, at the recent dialogue meeting, I called attention to the peer-reviewed report that came out in the Journal of Environmental Radioactivity, and I asked what was the EPA's disposition concerning this peer-reviewed report. I was promised that they would respond, and they have failed to respond. They have no official opinion about the scientific evidence that shows that there's been massive off-site contamination. So, with that, I would just like to say that there are some signs of hope because more people are pressing in and learning about this issue, and some of those people are the members of our youngest generation, which we're here to protect. Thank you.
I think that picture. That's the picture I was talking about, where she just simply raised the camera over her head and took it. I think that speaks volumes. That's the look of a group of people that's lost a lot of hope, and that were getting some very bad news that night, and they were getting it from their federal government, who really didn't seem to give a crud, and I think they all felt, they probably still do, like nobody was there to protect them. And I think that one last thing for hope, I think Byron's right, anything we can do to put hope up, we're all together. I met one of my best friends through this ordeal. And though I wish I didn't know it, I met a lot of you, and you know, John talked about all the fun things that this church is doing, and yeah, it sucks that that's happening less than a mile from the oldest radioactive waste in the world. But come on, this is a great community. There's good stuff happening here. We are worth saving. It is worth cleaning this mess up so we can get back to doing what we should be doing.
Questions? Anyone? We got about 8 more minutes.
Karen.
Comments too, or anybody want to say anything?
I have a question. By the end of the year, there was supposed to be a plan drawn up for the future of the landfill, and I haven't heard anything on it in recent months. Have I missed it?
No. The EPA is supposed to come out with what they think should be done with the site. Obviously, they made a decision in 2008 to leave the race there and cover it with some dirt, and that didn't go over well. And their own review board looked at it and said, what are you doing? And you're not even looking at the groundwater. They basically got a spanking from the interagency EPA at the very top. So to make a long story short, they were told to go back and restudy the site, which it's our opinion, and bipartisan, all of the elected officials, that they're not doing what they should as an agency to do that and properly characterize. Long story short, they're supposed to come out, they promised us, I believe, at the end of this December, so 2 months, they'd come out with a report about what to do with the radioactive waste. The problem, remember me telling about the groundwater, right? The problem is that they're not going to be finished studying the groundwater at the site for at least 2 more years. So our question is, how can you determine what to do with the radioactive waste without understanding its impact on the groundwater? I mean, that's really kind of silly. And this, here you go, here's EPA's responses. That's a good question. And the answer is, if we decide to do this with the waste and we start it, and then we determine a couple of years from now that there's something going on with the groundwater, it needs something else, well, we'll have to go back and completely redo. Wasteful spending. We would rather them measure once and measure twice, cut once. And so we're gonna have to hold our breath. I don't think that they liked the response they got when they gave that answer. There were a lot of elected officials in the room, Senator Blunt's staff, McCaskill's staff, Wagner, Representative Otto, everybody was at the table, and they basically told them, don't try. Don't do anything less than removal at this site, because anything less isn't going to be good enough. So no, we don't know. And they break promises so often, who knows?
A final question is whether or not I need to warn someone that I know who works at the airport to drink bottled water.
Ooh.
It's a young person.
There's no evidence. There's no evidence that it's in the drinking water. The drinking water is and takes are downstream from Westlake. There's no evidence it's in the drinking water. However, we don't really know if it's reached the river or not because they haven't done off-site testing. I would encourage them to call American Water. They do frequent tests for radiation, and they're saying no, that there's nothing in the water that would indicate it.
Do you trust them?
Well, what can you do about it?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, probably. Here's the issue with that. You don't want to get radiation's a lot more difficult to get out of drinking water than other chemicals. You know, you don't want it to happen. And even at this site, even though you worry about the radiation, you really worry about some of those other chemicals you're seeing in the groundwater making their way to the river. So the answer is American Water says it's okay, it's fine. Terry Bugoski said don't drink from a water well, which was an EPA consultant. She said if you have a water well, wouldn't recommend drinking from it, that the groundwater at the site is contaminated. So,
thank you.
Hope that helps.
It's kind of been mine and Don's motto. One of the reasons that we work so hard on this and get this information out to you is so that you guys can make your own decisions. So we can't tell you if it's good or bad. We can only put the information out there and make your own decisions. People ask us if they should move.
Every day they ask.
We can't answer that. We can only, again, put the information out there so that you guys can make educated arrangements for and do what's best for you and your family. Do you have a question? ATSDR?
She said that they were testing for alpha and beta particles in a water creek, and that beta particles.
Erin Evans with Army Corps and ATSDR said that they were testing for alpha particles and beta particles in cold water creek. And she said that the beta particles took a lot longer to test for because you couldn't just use a Geiger counter. So I would be very cautious about even relying on anything that Missouri American Water has put out there because I'm not sure they're testing for everything that could be there.
The hardest thing about testing for groundwater, remember how I told you guys it takes one test in the air? So it's the same with the water. You have to take a sample, it takes a while to get that sample back, and you know anything about water treatment plants. The goal is to get the water through, get it cleaned up real quick, get it out, so that keep it constant, you know, they don't want to back up. And so, yeah, some of that does take time. Maybe, if you guys are okay, what do you guys think? We can call American Water and see if they'd be willing to come out and talk and do a presentation. Maybe you got my help. Lots of elected officials in the room can probably help make that happen. But let's see what we can do about getting the app to happen.
Right, that's a great idea.
Yeah, and yep. You know what, that's what we'll do. So we'll reach out to American Water and MSC. Those boys haven't been put on the spot for a while, right? Mm-hmm. I think that helps
yeah.
Guys.
All right, so I think that's going to be it for tonight. Don't forget that our meeting is November 17th. Also, the church functions that are going to happen tomorrow night and then again the following weekend. So thank you all for coming, and we'll see you soon.